All right, here we go. We ready?
I guess.
Welcome to M Vibes Podcast.
Home of good music,
good libations,
and good vibes. Hello, and welcome to another episode of M Vibes Podcast. By hearing the music, you might guess what the topic is today, but we're back at our home sweet home, Tommy's Pub, with a very special guest, DJ Spider, in the house today.
Hello.
Hello.
Cheers.
We haven't been at Tommy's in a while, but cheers. Yeah, absolutely. Oh. Watch out for the cord. Oh, man. We haven't been back here in a few episodes, man, so it's... It's good to be home.
Yeah, with Mike Phillips.
Mike Phillips, but that was
back in
over a month ago.
Yeah, it was around the first week in March, I think. April.
Well, I mean, we're back at Tommy, so I don't even have to tell people what I'm drinking. But drinking Old Faithful Magners, and my only thing that goes with it, well, is Jameson.
You know, I would do that with a shot of Fireball.
You know, they changed Fireball. It's no longer got whiskey in it, so.
As long as it's cinnamony and warm, that makes me happy.
Yes. I didn't know it had whiskey in it to begin with.
Theoretically, it's a cinnamon whiskey.
I don't know what kind of whiskey it was, but anyways. What are you drinking, Spider?
I am drinking a sour. It's a black currant sour that's been aged in wine barrels, red wine barrels. And I forget the label. But it's delightful.
That sounds delicious.
I'm a late bloomer with ciders sours. I was sort of like, I love sours, but only in the winter. Now I'm like an all year round sour drinker. Yeah. If it's on tap, I'll definitely do a sour.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a good, easy drinking drink. Well, it was not too sour, because I have friends that have to drink Tums or take Tums after they drank sours all night long. So
I'm fine with the sours. It paces me. Like, you know, otherwise if it's something that's super sweet, I will suck that down in like... Like, and then suddenly I'm like, oh, my drink's gone. Time to start over.
Yep, start all over. And then
covering craft beer, I try to refine my palate into sours, but that's like my least favorite.
But everybody else in the world is an IPA person. I am not an IPA person. I have a very limited palate for IPAs. So I figured like what I'm leaving for you guys on the IPAs, I am covering that on the sour side. So the balance is like there.
I used to not like IPAs either. I had to refine my palate to get into IPAs. Yeah. So
they're just too hoppy for me. So they're too sharp.
Eventually, I'll refine my palate to sours.
Over the weekend, a box randomly showed up on my front porch. A dude that I trade with out of Maryland, shout out to Chris O, if he ever watches or listens to an episode, he randomly sent me a box of ciders and gluten-free beers. So
nice.
Yeah, I got a bunch of Departed Souls and a bunch of ciders I've never tried before. So
Cider is one of my go-tos anyway.
I love them, yeah.
Yeah, cider.
I mean, I used to make fun of people who drank cider, but just like everything else in my fucking life, when I start talking shit about something, it backfires on me. So now I drink ciders, meads, and gluten-free beers. So, and whiskey, of course.
But, so yeah. We were doing ginger beer for making mules. We discovered mules, you know, like the rest of the world did a few years ago. And then we were up in Lincolnton, of all places, earlier this year and discovered Ginger's Revenge.
Yes.
Oh, so
they're in
good.
Asheville, but yes.
They're out of Asheville, yes. But yeah, no, that's the first time I'd ever had it.
That's a
and
cool place to
now
go.
I'm rabid for that shit. Yes. Like, let me find it. I have to track it down. It is so good.
That's what I make my... mules with.
I see. Yes. I have not actually done that. I have not actually made a mule with it yet because it's so good on its own.
Yeah. And there's, I think the last one I had was a jalapeno chocolate one, I think.
Ooh.
Yeah. My service manager at work had me bought a 4-pack of them and he gave me half of them. So
yeah. No, they're outstanding.
Yeah, they are.
Yep.
Very cool tap room too, but it's kind of gothic. It's kind of dark and
have not been up to the tap room yet. I did make it up to Noble Cider's tap room a few years before the pandemic, so a million years ago, because that's how the time works in the real world. Is anything before the pandemic is a million years ago.
It was.
But that year didn't exist.
Yeah. No, actually, I want to take 2 years off my driver's license. I figure I've earned that. Those 2 years don't exist. Yeah. I need to just deduct those. We should all get a do-over on those.
Absolutely.
What are you drinking, Ernie?
I am...
He's drinking Old Faithful over there.
Old Faithful. I got Hop Drop and Roll. And I got some 10 High Sour Mash Whiskey.
Oh, okay.
Nice.
I thought you said you were going with Jameson.
Yeah, I changed my mind.
Turned your back on me.
Yeah, I did.
It's all right. Anyways, let's talk about our guest, DJ Spider. Let's talk about where you're from and your background with music.
Yeah.
And a little known fact, which we'll get into later. Spider and I used to work together, so.
Once again, a million years ago.
You know, it seems like it.
So it's 2020.
But it really wasn't.
Yeah, no, but honestly, like, I think you are probably among the very first people I met in Charlotte just because of where I worked.
Really?
So, yeah, you may be some of the people I've known the longest in this town. Okay. So,
well, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, you can, if there was a top fan badge for that, for this, you could yeah. add that to your profile. Let's see, where am I from? This is it's not a complicated story, but everybody always goes, now wait, what? So I originally, I grew up in the Virgin Islands in the Caribbean. From there, I went to college in Indiana and then went back home after I graduated and was there for until about 99 and then moved to Atlanta for a few years, then ended up in Charlotte. I followed a boy. The boy didn't work out, but the city did, so I stuck around.
I know that story.
Yeah, you know that story. Yeah. And then, but honestly, the DJing thing started, let me start off by saying I have no musical talent whatsoever. My dad was a jazz clarinetist, so I grew up with music around the house, and I loved music. But it wasn't until my senior year of high school when we did a school dance, and our honor society was the sponsor for the school dance, and we needed DJs. So three girls got together, and I was one of them. We called ourselves Broken Nail. And we had two stereos with, like, the cassette players and the radios and the whole thing mm-hmm. set up. This was before CDs because I'm very old.
It was like two speakers and a microphone?
Hey, kind of. But
I used those, too. Cassette singles were yes. the bomb, man.
And we were sitting there. We had two of those set up, and you were, like, fast-forwarding and rewinding to yep. play things. I'm pretty sure we played the same song maybe four times in that night. But we made it through. So that would have been 1989, which means by now I have been DJing since then. If you count that, I did radio in college. Came out of that, did radio after I graduated from college, and then moved in club work after that, sort of accidentally. I've been a DJ for like 34 years now. And
that's impressive.
It's impressive because I have people are like, oh, you should sing in a band. You've got so much stage presence. I'm like, no. I can carry a note, but there are these big gaps between the notes. So yes. it's not pretty and it's not good. And I tried taking piano classes. I tried to learn music. I just don't have a knack for it, but I can count to four and I can push play. So that is my skill. And I mean, obviously there's other things that go with it, but there's reading a room. There's like knowing the music. It's instincts, but those come over time. But so that's the short story of me becoming a DJ. I kind of just fell into it, but at this point in my life, I'm like, you know, when the path opens up in front of you, like, take it. Like, you don't know where it's going to take you, but you've got to, you know, you can second guess yourself the whole way. You've got to make a choice. It may be the wrong choice. You may regret the choice, but you've made the choice. So take the next step and see what happens. Graduated from high school. I thought I was going to end up being an English teacher or a comic book illustrator. Totally didn't expect to be a DJ. Was not on my list of things to do whatsoever. Wow. But here we are 34 years later, and I'm still doing it.
But it's fun.
It is.
It's fun to read a crowd.
Yes.
And learn what they're going to dance to.
Yep.
Sometimes it's a real pain in the ass, but eventually when they drink enough alcohol, they'll dance to anything. So
they will dance to anything, as the Smith said. Yeah. Not the Smiths, the dead milkman.
Oh yeah.
Yes, you'll dance to anything. It's interesting. It's fun reading, but it's also that art of crafting a whole night, like right. learning how to like start it slow, do the early, like don't be the dipshit that comes in here and like you're opening for like a band, or you're opening for another DJ. Don't play all the big bangers like in your 9 to 10 set. Like that's, right. I appreciate that you want to play that good stuff, but this is your chance to like, you should be the supporting act. You're kind of like the ambiance to build mm-hmm. up to that point and let like the next person shine. Eventually it'll be your time to shine.
Yeah.
But I love those early sets because I get to play stuff that doesn't really drive a dance floor, but people are out there nodding their heads and they're kind of like, grooving a little bit, and you get to play stuff that's deeper cuts. Somebody always comes up and asks, what is this? My favorite thing in the entire world. Holy crap, that's my favorite thing to hear, is somebody coming up and going, who is this? And then me scrambling, because I never have a piece of paper around, scrambling to write stuff down. give me a cocktail napkin. And scrambling it and writing it down, handing it to them, knowing that they're going to go find them, and it's going to open them up to a whole album or a whole band.
Yes, that's
and
awesome.
And sharing that music, I mean, that makes me happier than anything else.
I love that part of it, too. Well, back in the day, I did a lot of weddings, so I would actually love the part where I could play, like, the dinner mm-hmm. music, and I would play a month, like deep cuts of blues or some really obscure, low tempo alternative stuff.
Yeah.
And I was like, wow, I finally get to play this stuff to people. I mean, no one's, yes, you got those one or two people that are actually listening, but for the most part, no one even cares. So,
no, but it seeps in. It seeps into their unconsciousness, and then they're just like, wait, I've heard this before. That's why I love cover songs so much.
Oh my
like,
God, I love covers.
I could do an entire, I mean, I've done Twitch streams that are nothing but covers. Covers are like my secret deep passion.
Speaking of covers.
Yes.
Do you like Three Teeth?
Yes.
That Pumped Up Kicks.
Oh, I love that cover.
Yes.
So good.
They were, before the pandemic, they were going to play Carolina Rebel or Epic Fest.
Yeah.
And it canceled. I was like, God damn, it was my one chance to see them. So nowadays, you do a lot of club shows.
I do. I don't do as much radio. I mean, it was weird. During the pandemic, Twitch became a whole thing. And yes. Twitch was almost like doing radio. But because, I mean, but there was nobody to play to, so you right. kind of, I was played to my cats, you know. And
I
then
saw
I had
you
to talk
go live a few times.
Yeah, and trying to manage, like, the whole, sorry, I love this track.
It's awesome.
So good.
Yes, it is.
It was weird because all of a sudden there was this whole extra level of, like, it's not just the music. Now there was video involved, and that yes. was, like, a whole extra yes. line of bullshit that I was like, okay, I am not an AV engineer in any way, shape, or form. But okay, we'll see if we can figure it out. And there were challenges, but I got really lucky that people were, I mean, I'm very lucky that there are people out there that like me enough to help me, you know, and not everybody is helpful. But I think particularly in our scene and particularly the groups that I run in, they were like, oh wait, I can help you with this. Oh, I know how to do this. This is how I set this up. We did this. And all that stuff made a huge difference. So that's, I still absolutely screw up half the time. Don't get me wrong. And it was really nice to get out of Twitch because I didn't have to worry about spell checking myself when
oh
I was
God,
talking.
Oh, God, I'm terrible at that.
Like, DJing and trying to spell at the same time. Like, I cannot multitask
and
that
then
way.
Trying to read everyone that's following. Hey, yeah. Oh,
exactly.
I gotta play music.
Yeah. what am I doing? I've got to go back and forth. The Twitch thing was great, but now we're back in real time and we're back in real life, so it's all club stuff. And, I mean, for me, a club is anything from a bar to, like, you know, something that holds, you know, 2,000 people. 6,000 people. It doesn't matter. Like, for me, it's about the people itself. But when I listen to music and when I'm like previewing tracks or checking out an album, most of me is listening for a dance floor. There's still part of me that's listening for stuff I enjoy. Mm-hmm. But I typically, like, I may skip through an album in like 20 minutes or 15 minutes because I'm like, if you don't catch me in the first minute on a dance floor level, like, you know, like, okay, this is a good beat, I'm going to skip ahead to the next one. I'll go back and listen to it fully again. But initially, like, my first run through on an album or on a single or something, it's like, does it got a beat? Can you dance to it? You know, like, how are people going to react to this? So it's interesting. And being able to then take that to a dance floor and then just think about, like, the venue that you're in, what kind of club is it? Like, you know, going from, like, the Milestone here in Charlotte down to Atlanta at Dragon Con, which is a big giant, like, 2 a.m. rave kind of thing. That's with, you know, 2,000 people there. That's a completely different vibe than the Milestone with, you know, 150 people. Just and just how people are dressed, the vibe, the skills. Every town is different. Every city is different. I was up in Raleigh back in February, spinning at the Wicked Witch, which is a fabulous venue.
Ooh,
a great,
I haven't heard of that place.
No, Wicked Witch is great. Good people. The Night Rider downstairs, Wicked Witch is upstairs. Fantastic bar, fantastic staff. I would do them again. I would do them again in a heartbeat. No, I would spin there again in a heartbeat. They're fabulous. They have a very solid team. They're very cohesive. And then I'm in Augusta, you know, coming up on Saturday. So, you know, for me, it's again, it's like I've been in Augusta since before the pandemic. So it's going to be reading that crowd. It's going to be figuring out the vibe.
Yep.
You know, are we all fancy dressed? Is it like a harder core, like, you know, EBM kind of like hardcore dance kind of night? Or is it going to be more just like, we just want to hear our favorites? Do you want new stuff? Do you want old stuff? It's that balance of figuring it out, which is part of the challenge and part of the fun of doing the whole DJ thing, I think.
Is.
Yeah. Yeah.
When I lived back home in Detroit, there were 5 songs I had to play all every night because there was a Detroit thing. And I moved down here and I had to learn all over again. It was a whole new thing.
Yep. No, it is. And it changes. I mean, over in my old age, it has changed over time. You know, it's interesting. Like, you know, stuff that I was playing, like, you know, in the 90s, people are requesting, you know, again. And I'm like, I played this the first time. Yeah. And the second time it came around. But again, like 80s stuff, like I danced to it in high school, and then I DJed it, and then it went away, and then it came back, and then it went away, and then it came back.
It's funny how things are changing, but it's all comes back around again.
It does, but it's also interesting the bands that have continued to stick around, like Depeche Mode, like still touring, The Cure, still touring. All these
Gary
bands.
Gary fucking Newman that you saw last night. Sorry.
He was fantastic.
I am pissed. I missed that show.
He was my big draw last night.
Yeah.
Absolutely my big draw.
Oh, I love it when my kids are like, oh, man, I love this song, and it's by, you know, a current artist. And I'm like, oh, that was done by so-and-so back 20 years ago.
That's a cover.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
I've got parents that are bringing their kids out to my gigs now because the kids are now 18, now 21 years old. Mm. And I'm like, oh, this is why I haven't seen you for the last, like, 15 years. Okay, gotcha. Well, I understand. But also, like, they're wearing mom's clothes because it's cool and retro. So, like, all those trip pants. Here's the thing. Everything comes around every 20 years.
Right.
You know, that's just how things cycle. In the 80s, the 60s were cool. In the 90s, you had all those 70s clubs like Polyesters and all those. Disco was the hot thing. Right now, mall goth. Hot topic, early 2000s. That's why emo is so hot right now. Mm-hmm. That is why, like, you're seeing all the freaking JNCOs and, like, that whole 90s style that's coming around again. And I'm sitting here in the early 2000s, and I'm sitting here going, I have done this already, and I'm pretty sure I still have those clothes in the closet, even though I can't wear them anymore because they don't fit, but I haven't let them go because I've got too many memories. Dude, seriously, I've gone looking. Yes. It's like, oh, I wonder if this comes in a larger size. I wonder if this comes with a larger wallet. Holy crap. Like, the prices on things are just huge.
It's insane.
It's
everything's
ridiculous.
Expensive.
Yeah, it is. Well, I mean, everything's expensive, but if you think you've got something, you will hoard it, and you'll try and make the most out of it. So, and I am a cheap bastard by nature, so if I can hunt down a bargain, I will hunt down a bargain. So,
hell yeah.
Yeah. So, no, but it's been interesting to meet those kids and see how they've reacted to, like, you know, because it's your parents' music. Like, is that cool? Is that not cool?
Yeah. You know? My daughter Dawson loves my music, but my older one, Brooklyn, could give two shits less. We'll be driving. Dad, can we listen to something I want to hear? And I'm like, you know what? I can't wait until you're driving.
Yep.
And I'm sitting in the back seat, and I can say, hey, Brooklyn, can we listen to something I like? You know?
Yep. It was funny. Last night, DJ Price was out with his son, and his son, one of his sons is starting to, like, you know, his oldest is, like, now coming up and listening to dad stuff. So he's out there because his dad's a huge ministry fan. So was out there and apparently fucking loved it, which is great. Like, I love that. But apparently his other son is not as enthusiastic about very loud music. So, but, you know, it's going to happen. You can't make everybody happy, but it's also one of those things. It's just interesting to watch it change and also see these artists that have been around forever, a whole new generation embracing. Like, I was at the ministry show, and I expected it to be like an AARP convention. Like, I really expected all of us. I really expected it to be that. And looking around, I saw a lot of faces. Exactly. Well, to be fair, the fact that Al is still alive and kicking is amazing.
He looks good. He still sounds good. But
he still sounds good. Yeah. And Gary Newman, holy, he was insane. Like, I will never miss another show from him again. He was amazing.
He's on my list.
Yeah,
I've been going to a lot of shows here as of late, so I'm starting to have to pick and choose now. Man.
Yeah.
Jesus, I've been to a shit ton of shows here as of late, so yeah.
But you know what? It's a Skinny Puppy played here in Charlotte a couple of weeks ago, and
I was there.
I missed that show because I was out of town, so I came in the day after. But what made me happier than anything else, and it wasn't just Charlotte, was seeing my friends as Skinny Puppy has hit other cities and toured other places where I have friends, is how many people have been out there meeting up with people they haven't seen in 15, 20 years, you know? And it's awesome because it's kind of like, oh, that's amazing. Like, you haven't, this music still brings people together. Like, they haven't seen each other in a while, but you could, across the aisle and across the audience, they're pointing at each other and going, oh, man, it's
you. Oh, I haven't seen you forever.
I know. And that's, again, it's the music doing that. And that's what's, fantastic.
It was actually funny that night. Everyone's like, where's Spider? And someone said, oh, she's out of town.
Well, I'm I'm amazed that anybody missed me because I pretty much hogged my own little section of the dance floor last night. And I realized that I have been dancing from the waist up behind a DJ booth for so long, I have no idea how the bottom half of my body works anymore. I'm pretty sure I look like a drunk flamingo from the waist down trying
I'm
to
I'm a great stool dancer.
I can bob my head, I can move my shoulders. Everything is good.
Thank you.
Yeah, so, but it was still, I mean, I'm paying it for this morning because apparently now I've reached that age where I need to stretch before I go out. I need to do a little, like, shoulder rolls and, like, myself stretched out.
I turned 50 this year, but I still can't.
So young.
I still can't not get in a fucking mosh pit. I was at Obituary Friday night. I'm like, well, fuck it. Let's go.
But you know what's interesting, though, is that the older punks and older goths, the people that have experienced mosh pits before, mm-hmm. actually are really good about, like, maintaining it's the pit. And
we get a lot of respect in the pit by all the younger kids.
Right, but you're also really good about protecting the people on the outside of the pit and catching and everything. And I was in, when I was in Chicago for Cold Waves back in September, saw, like, Front 242 and Mitzareb and just fantastic. But the whole, naturally, a pit started. Yeah. And it's like, you know, I plant my feet on the outside of it because I'm not in a pit kind of mood. But I was also just waiting to just push through and everything. Yeah. But just watching people, like, if anybody fell, immediately somebody went to go make sure they were okay. And that's something you don't think about. Like, people don't realize that a mosh pit is not this crazy place where people just beat the crap out of each other.
Oh, see, you're right, though, because a lot of people think that. Oh, you're going to go in there and get hurt. I'm like, no, man, it's full of love.
Yeah, it is.
Everyone's
in
there just letting off some steam, man.
Yeah, and it's understood that that's what's going on.
Yes.
You know, and it's the same thing, like, within the goth scene. I have conversations with people all the time. It's like, oh, you guys were all the spikes and chains and all that stuff. You guys are mean. I'm like, you know what? Back in the day, up in Greensboro, there was a club called Dizzy G's. And Dizzy G's, at 2 a.m. turned into a rave club. Like, they had a new set of DJs came in, but they did, like, a goth night before that. Mm-hmm. And we'd be there, spikes, chains, you know, leather, the whole nine yards. But those guys, and granted, this was like the 2000s, but those guys sitting and, like, waiting to come at 2 a.m. with their wife beaters and their big wide jeans, they all got patted down because they were considered a bigger threat than the goths. Because we police ourselves. Like, and, like, I've seen so many people who've gone just, like, if something starts to erupt, it's usually not anybody who's a regular.
Right.
Like, it's somebody who doesn't understand the flow and then, you know, what the, I hate to call it the rules, but there's certain things, like, just because a girl is wearing, like, a low-cut blouse does not mean she is available for you to, like, make grabby hands with, you know, kind of thing, which should be international. Like, that should just be a rule. But some people just haven't been raised that way. Y'all's moms did not raise you right. But smack you on the hands. But, you know, when stuff like that breaks down, most people are just like, take it outside. Do not get the club in trouble. Like, you know, this is not the place for this. Like, everybody tries to diffuse the situation as quickly as possible. And interestingly enough, DJing, I can bring down, like, if when I see, because when you're in a DJ booth, you can see the whole floor.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
That's one of the advantages. Like, for me, if I'm working a club I don't know, I find security. I'm like, okay, how do I let you know if I see something? Because I will have a better vantage point than you will in this club. But if I see something start to get weird or out of hand, you can diffuse that. Just by changing the music, you can just completely flip to something stupid cheesy and, like, the whole thing will just kind of mellow out, you know, or just bring down the volume.
Yeah.
It does not have to be like, you know, Chumbawamba Tumthup and, you know, it's banging at your head or whatever. Man, Lou Bega, Mamba Number 5, bring that shit around, you know.
Yeah.
Everybody will immediately start, like, grooving and chatting and moving their heads. And that's, like, it's amazing to me how music can do that, like how you can change the entire mood in a night. And that's, like, for me, my closing song for almost 20 plus years, my closing song has almost always been Kermit the Frog, Rainbow Connection. Because nobody leaves unhappy when you hear Kermit the Frog. There is no way you can leave sad. I refuse to believe that you're going to have a bad night after you've heard the Rainbow Connection. And I was super lucky a few years ago down in Atlanta. I got to actually play the Dark Crystal Ball.
Oh, yeah, I saw you.
At the Puppetry Arts Center. And I actually got to play the Rainbow Connection while Brian Henson was there within literal, like, feet of an original Kermit the Frog. Like, I was like, all right, I'm done.
Yep.
Peace out.
That's awesome.
Yeah, that was my personal mic drop moment, you know.
There you go.
And I didn't even get a chance to really look around until we went back a couple of months later, and I actually got to go through, and I'm like, well, thank God I didn't walk this place earlier. I would have cried the entire night. I would have been a mess. There's Big Bird. He was one of my first heroes.
Yes.
Yeah. So, But we haven't really, like, in Charlotte particularly, like, I do play clubs, but most of what I'm doing right now is goth industrial stuff, which is super interesting, only because, again, it's coming back around. It's kind of I wouldn't say it's an offshoot of emo, but emo got more of the press and publicity in the 2000s. And got more attention on MTV and all those places.
Yeah.
And this kind of bubbled under. But it's interesting because Twitch brought so many bands back out of hiding and brought so many bands, you know, and people that had moved and they didn't have a scene in their area, they reconnected on Twitch. And they hadn't seen friends in so long and they were chatting on Twitch. And so this new energy came out of it. Like Stabbing Westward released a new album last year.
I saw
it. And it's fantastic.
And they're touring.
It's so good. Like I expected this was going to be an album I was going to bump through.
Yeah.
And I was going to hear like maybe two songs that I dug. You know, it's fine. I listened to that whole thing straight through. Start to finish, and I was just like, it's like they've never left, but it doesn't sound dated. It doesn't sound, I mean, and that kind of amazing energy and that kind of like people bringing that passion back. And so now there's just been this whole resurgence of post-punk and goth and industrial and synth pop and all the different permutations and subgenres that we have within it. And people are embracing it. And I learned so much from people that come up and ask for bands, and I'm just like, who? What?
What?
Bandcamp is my crack. Like Bandcamp, I can spend hours on Bandcamp and I will still never explore everything. When they were doing Bandcamp Friday, I called it Bankrupt Friday because I would buy all the things. So much money went to, which was great because it goes to bands. But,
right, yeah, yeah.
Which is fantastic. But it's like bands are self-producing now. Like, you know, 20 years ago, like when you and I were working together, you know, Eric and I were working together at Media Play back in the day when I first moved to Charlotte. And I've the music department.
Music department, represent.
Represent.
I was going to say, we'll have to explore that story right there.
Yeah. Store 1010. So it was interesting because people would come in not knowing quite what they were looking for and how you shared music and how you talked about music. Mm-hmm. Then you would make a mixtape for somebody or burn a CD for somebody.
Oh, that was awesome. Yeah. I love making
mixtapes. Mixtapes for people, yeah. And then we ended up with this weird, like social media came along and people talked to each other, but they stopped sharing music. Like they didn't put up bands. They didn't put up videos. So I never knew what anybody was listening to or nobody, there's nothing new coming out. I'm like, well, there is.
There is. You just don't see it anymore.
You don't see it. But now with Twitch and now with Bandcamp and people are actually cross-posting stuff and they're talking about stuff and they're sharing bands and bands are being very good about talking to their fans. Right. That makes a big difference. Like every band that's come through Charlotte since the pandemic ended, quasi-ended, whatever's going on there. Ever since the band started touring again, everybody has been so genuinely nice. Like, yes. I can't help but not want to support them and talk about them. And I consider them friends, you know? And mm-hmm. it's so great because I want to share in their successes. I want to share in their, you know, you guys have to hear these people. And that's why I always post my playlists after a gig because I'm like, you guys, don't come up to me and say, what was that song you played between this and this? I don't know. I literally will not remember. Like, it's
how do you keep track of it, though?
My software, my DJ software. All right. Now I used to write stuff down, but then I realized that at about 1 a.m. I can't read my own handwriting anymore. It's a scrawly thing. And I don't know what this is. Like I'm looking, I was like, I played something. It was 4 minutes long. I don't know what that is. Yeah.
I was saying, you know, Twitch is not a platform that I have considered because I always thought that as like a gamer's platform.
See, I did too, but it became this whole, like the DJ community has really sprung up in there and there's, it's interesting because
I've checked.
Definitely explore.
Double back on that one.
Yeah, and it's interesting because you've got bands that are doing. They were doing shows through Twitch, like they were just broadcasting. DJ,
oh, nice.
DJ shows are just going on like all the time there. Just conversations, interviews. It's actually interesting because it becomes that challenge of like music rights and everything.
Oh yeah.
Part of me is mildly annoyed because it's freaking Amazon. Amazon can afford to pay.
Right.
BMI and ASCAP.
I
see you, Amazon.
I've tried going live on like Instagram,
mm-hmm.
DJing at the house, and just get shut down.
You'll get shut down because the algorithms and everything are reading the digital files, which I get. And even with Twitch, I mean, I don't save, like I'll record my sets straight to my system, but as long as you don't save the video to your Twitch stream, like in your Twitch library, they can't really knock you for it. Like it's a one-time stream out there kind of thing, and so they can't really knock you. But even on YouTube, like I have a friend who actually, he was getting docked for his own music. Like it's his band.
Oh, wow.
And they were like silencing it, and he was getting DMCA requests and everything. Huh. And it was just like, he's like, hi, it's my music. I wrote it. I should be fine with this.
In vibes coming soon to Twitch.
Yeah. Explore. I mean, it's
why not?
The Twitch community is super supportive too, and it's great. I mean, there's always going to be, there's always that one guy or girl or they or person or whatever. There's one idiot, and that's fine.
Kind of like Reddit.
Yes.
And Discord.
Yes, exactly. And actually, a lot of Twitch DJs have set up Discords. Like, Discord is like the new MySpacey, Facebooky, private group thingo or whatever. Yeah. But that's interesting, too. I mean, it's interesting. I don't get on Twitch as much as I did during the pandemic, only because real life is real life, and it sucks. And sometimes you just, I can't find the time to do it.
Better in person.
It's better in person. And I enjoy, like, feeding off of stuff. But there's still too much music that I don't get a chance to share. So if I do get a chance to get on, I will do it. But Twitch, again, just completely revived the goth industrial scene in a way I don't think any of us expected it to. And it's really just, I mean, it was always it was always there. It's just that people suddenly connected to it. And I think that's why in our scene in particular, not only in Charlotte, but across the U.S., I'm seeing goth used to skip a generation. Like, you'd have the elder goths. And then there'd be nothing. And then there'd be the baby bats. And nobody knew how they found the scene. And it was always like, oh, if it's not Bauhaus and if I'm not farting cobwebs, it's not real music. And then the baby bats are all just like raver, like tiny sparkle, happy Hello Kitty stuff. But it can all coexist. Like, it can all be together. And that's like my whole thing has always been like, I've jokingly called it my gothic outreach program. Like, if you see somebody who's enjoying the music, it's about the music. Like, I don't care what you're wearing. I don't care if your hair is brown, blue, green, bald. I don't care. Like, if you're enjoying the music, let's talk about the music. Like, have a good time. In the end, I just want you to have a good time at the night. I don't care what your background is. If you want to request something, come request something. If I can play it, I will. If it works, like, I'm known for throwing left ball shit out there. Like, you want to hear Salt and Pepper? Okay, let's do Salt and Pepper. Let's just see what happens. And it's like you don't know until you try it. But everybody has embraced so many different kinds of music. No one person is only like, I am only an industrial person. I have never heard anything else. Sweet Caroline comes on and everybody's singing along. Yeah. So you can't say that. You are only one kind of person.
It's funny you say that. Because I was just thinking, throw on Sweet Caroline.
See? Yeah, exactly. There's always that one song.
That's exactly what I was thinking about.
Yep. So, and I think right now, because, you know, there's this new, again, we jokingly call them the baby bats, but I don't think they're bats anymore. I don't think it's strictly goth. I think it's just this an entirely new breed of music lovers that are young. You know, they're 18 to 25. They're young, and they're listening to everything, and they love everything, and it matches either their mood. And I think they're just as likely to buy, like, Halsey or Pink as they are to buy, you know, Hante or, you know, Dead Cool. You know, it's really massive.
It's much easier to find it now, too.
So much easier.
You don't have to go into a store and go dig through the bins to find something that you think looks cool.
Right.
You can check it out on Spotify. Everything's on there. Yeah,
just listen to it ahead of time. And then also because, like, places like Bandcamp, which is, they're set up like social media sites, you can see when one of your friends has bought something.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, if you go to your music feed, you can see so-and-so just bought this, so-and-so just bought this, so-and-so, the bands you follow, just released this. And then you can start to see that. One of my favorite things is that you have your Bandcamp collection, all the stuff that you bought. If anybody else buys something out of your collection or because they saw you bought it, you get a Booyakasha email that comes to you. And it's a Booyakasha. And I love that. I'm like, somebody found something because I liked it or I bought it, and I love that. Like, that makes me happy. I've shared music accidentally or sideways, you know, kind of done it. But again, it's the music that makes me totally happy. But it's also like, have a good time, have a good vibe. I'm really excited with Charlotte right now because we've had, you know, we're at Tommy's Pub tonight. They do a night once a month called Reflections.
Yep.
And then there's another goth-adjacent night called Shadow Play, which is over at Crown Station once a month, which is a little bit more 80s, 90s. Uh-huh. And then I do Digital Noir with DJ Price out at the Milestone once a month. We all work together, so we didn't schedule stuff on top of each other. You know, we were like, because it doesn't help anybody to that. I mean, yes, sometimes the venue, the venue works against you. Like, they book other stuff, and that happens.
Yeah, that's here, too, with us.
That's absolutely... I totally understand that. Like, you can't fight that. But
jazz night.
But at the same time, like, it doesn't take that much effort to just reach out and go, we're all one scene. Like, I feel very like, we're all one scene.
Right.
But I feel like at the same time, everybody's stronger as a result. Like, if you could go into any night and we're not competing with each other, we're all working with each other. It doesn't take that much. Like, I've gone to other scenes and immediately they're like, oh, well, these people are awful or these people are terrible. I'm like, why? Did they poop in your shoe? I don't understand why they're terrible. You're all doing the same thing. If this is your only source of income, yes, I get you're going to be a little bit defensive about it. But I think most of us, none of us can survive being full-time DJs. So most of us have to have a day job.
It's a paying hobby, kind of. Yeah,
it is. It's my fun money, is what I call it. It's my discretionary fund. But it's, I mean, it doesn't take that much. But if we can all share the music and we can all like what we're doing and we can all like just.
It's a great feeling.
It is. It is. It is. I love walking into any of those other nights that I'm not responsible for the music. Holy crap. How nice is that? Like, that was the best thing about the show last night. Gary Newman Ministry, Frontline Assembly. I did not have to push play for any of it. I could show up when I wanted to. I could leave when I wanted to. I could pee when I wanted to. It was amazing.
Wow.
And that's what I love. It's like just being able to go and enjoy a night for the sake of enjoying the night and enjoying the music. And that's what it, to me, that's what it's about.
Is that the latest show you've been to? I mean, have you been to any other shows besides that?
Music, concerts?
Yeah.
I mean, most of the stuff's been maybe a little bit smaller, like at the Milestone. Milestone and Snug Harbor. So,
Snug Harbor.
Yeah, so the last show I saw at Snug was Dead Cool with Rose Garden Funeral Party.
Okay.
And I forget who opened for them. But Dead Cool is out of North Carolina, and they are out of Wilmington, actually. They are currently in Europe touring, doing mini tour.
Okay.
They are straight up goth rock, and they are, again, the nicest people on the planet. Super nice people, but they've got a very traditional goth rock kind of style. Sisters of Mercy, if you like Sisters of Mercy, that would be that end of the goth spectrum.
Okay.
It's very, I mean, it's just keyboards and vocals and, you know, dead shit. You know, that's like the spooky goth dead shit. But Dead Cool is great. Super people. But, you know, just the scene itself is bubbling up because you've got them out of Wilmington. Here in Charlotte, we've got Tenderlash, which is more dark wave. We've got Io, which is a little bit more synth pop, synth wave. You've got Solemn Shapes, which is a little bit more experimental, industrial on that end of things. I'm sure I'm forgetting somebody, and I'm going to hate myself after I get
that's
off the
right.
air. I'm going to kick myself. But even all the scenes, like I've tried to bring in guest DJs from Raleigh and just around the Charlotte area, because go travel, go see other scenes, like go see other nights. Don't think like what we do here in Charlotte, like I tell people, it's like this is not the end all be all of like Gotham. I go to another city and a song that I play all the time in Charlotte will fall flat there, you know, because they're like, I don't know what this is, because they know another song off the album. And that's just, you know, so it's kind of like that's not their big hit.
Yeah.
Same thing with the people. Like you can, I love going to other nights and going, oh, there goes our Michael. There goes our Jennifer.
Yeah.
You know, like you can you play doppelganger and you find like the similarities. But you find people and you find like we're not that different. Like wherever you go in the country, you're not that different. And and the bands touring kind of drag it behind them like, I don't know, like crop dusting? I don't know what to call it. It's like, but they're just like, you know, they're dragging like positive energy with them and bringing stuff from other scenes and other areas that they're trying to bring together. And it's just great. It should just, that's how it should always be.
We drove down to Atlanta for a big metal show at the Masquerade.
Oh.
But it was
different Masquerade than it was 10, 15 years
ago. Yes, I pulled up and I'm like, this is not the same Masquerade I was at before.
Nope.
But you're right, though. Like, that vibe, the whole audience was just completely different from the metal crowd or punk crowd I've ever met up here. But everyone was cool as hell. So, I mean, it's funny. The guy that I go to these shows with, this guy that, like, sits still and doesn't move all night long. He just stands there.
Yep.
But me, I'm a social fucking butterfly.
I see your little wings.
And I go around and I'm talking to people all night long, man. I'm like, fuck that. I'm going to go talk to people, man. I mean, I'm here with no wife and kids. I got nothing else to do. So I'm going to go talk to people, man. So
yours, I mean, did you know Ken Lloyd?
I don't think so.
He was what we called a traveler of tribes. I could take Ken anywhere. Like, it was like 6 degrees of separation. Anywhere you went in the country, somebody would know Ken. Like, somebody would know some. He was just one of those guys that, and he would go anywhere at the drop of a hat. And he, like, I went to DJ Dracula's Ball up in Philly, and he was like, I want to come. I'm like, okay, come. Mm-hmm. And, like, I went to go DJ. I came back down. Like, I took a break. You know, DJ took over. And I came down, and he already knew, like, 20 people. And had made, like, dinner plans. And I was just, like, he was just that genuine person who absolutely embraced everything. And unfortunately, we lost him before the pandemic.
Yes.
Now you know exactly what I'm talking about.
Yep.
And we lost him suddenly. But I think what he always brought is just he lived life just, like, go see the shows. Like, go make friends. Travel. You know, and those are the things that if he left anything, it was just to be that Go travel. Go see things. Go embrace life.
Go do shit.
Go do shit. But also, don't you mean everybody's different. Like, I'm not going to force you. If you're not a chatty person, I'm not going to force you to talk to me. But I am totally happy to sit there. Like, I was in Austin a couple of weeks ago, sitting at a bench at a club, and immediately, like, four people sat down. I was just like, oh, so this is the table where all the people dressed in black sit. And everybody laughed. And then we just kind of, and immediately, weirdly enough, found somebody who knew somebody in Charlotte, like, within, like, 5 minutes. So, but again, that vibe, just talking and chatting with people. And, like, at the end of the night, I'd ended up having, like, two conversations about sociopolitical impacts of the current government status. And, like, cool tats, bro. It was a really, like, very varied conversations, but I wouldn't have had them if I was just sitting there staring at my phone. So, people, put down your phones. Right. Put your heads up. Look around. It's amazing. It's amazing what you might be missing.
I love talking to people. I fucking love it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Well, you're easy to talk to.
Well, it's... I am. I'm a very nice guy. I know what I look like, and that puts off a lot of people, but I'm a very nice guy. And then when I tell them I have a fucking podcast, man, the fucking doors open up, and it's conversations for hours, man. So
Every time I say I'm a DJ, people look at me like I'm like, I've grown a second head. Like,
really?
Yeah, there's... When I DJ, okay, this was what's weird. Within the goth scene, it's not so much of an issue, but when I DJ like a mainstream pop night, which does happen, like I can do a mainstream... You give me the music, I can figure it out, you know, and I've always been, I like all kinds of music. So yeah,
I just did a kid's party.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so you can do weddings. I can't do weddings. I'm terrible at weddings. I am awful at weddings.
I was going to say, a lot of people, when they hear DJs, oh, do you do weddings?
Yes. And I'm not.
Same for me when they say, oh, you're a photographer. Do you do weddings?
Yeah.
No.
Exactly.
No, but I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Weddings are a fucking nightmare sometimes, though. A nightmare. So,
Yes. That's why I stopped doing weddings. Yeah. A long time ago.
It stresses me out.
You get that fucking bridezilla that wants her music and only my music.
Oh, no. Yeah. Mother of the bride.
Mother of the bride.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Parents. Why are you playing this? This has swear words in it. Yeah. Ah, come on, man. It's 2 o'clock in the morning. We're all drunk already.
Yeah. There's certain, I mean, I've done the last few weddings. All my friends, please stop getting married. I'm not doing anymore. But I've done, for my friends, I'm good. Yeah. But like other things, I'm just like, I would love to. Invite me. I would love to be there. But like, I'm just going to be totally stressed out and I will not enjoy myself. And that makes me personally unhappy. But again, it's one of those things where, you know, going out and doing a pop night, at the same time, you can see those rhythms and those things churning and watching. Yes, no, do this, do that. And people are chatting and moving around and doing 10,000 different things, but they're doing things. They're looking up from their phones. They're traveling. They're dancing.
They're talking.
They're talking. And it's just great. And I had a point to this, and I'm rambling now. Sorry. I forget what it was. It's okay.
I think I fucked you up.
That's okay. I'm just going to drink again, and we'll be fine. Cheers.
It's all right, though.
It'll come to me. It's going to come to me in like 20 minutes, and suddenly I'm going to veer off in conversation.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. There was this thing I was going to say. Hold on.
Actually, I forgot what you were saying, too. So.
And we're looking to you now.
I was going to say, so I rewind.
But no, just the music. I mean, ultimately, it's about the music. And
so I'm sure you do it because I do. When I'm at an event where there's a DJ that's having a really hard time with the audience, he just cringes. You go like, oh, man, I feel so bad for him. And you kind of walk up and say, hey, man, play this, and they might dance to it. But you don't want to be that guy that walks up and says, hey, I'm also a DJ. Play this. And they're like, nah, fuck
you.
But you
know
what?
I think it's trial by fire. I mean, you'll never, I mean, you have to hone those instincts. You've got to figure it out. And I've actually, I'm not a fancy DJ. Like, I don't scratch. I don't do remixes. I don't wiki wiki woo any of the wiki wiki woos. Like, I'm not DJ Jazzy Spider. That is not me. And I'm just there for the good time and crafting the party, the vibe and the party and everything and making sure everybody has a good time. But there are some basic rules and there's some basic things that, you know, every DJ should know how to do. And I actually, way back in the day, a million years ago, took a class on it. Like, that was one of the things I did. So I actually traveled from the islands up to Houston and I took a class for a week with like a whole like DJ thing. So there's certain, I still have my little book, my little booklet with all the rules and the lessons in it.
I would like to read that book.
It's actually interesting. Like, I've actually talked about, like, I might just do some very small, like, I don't want to call them DJ classes, but if you're interested, because everybody's interested, is like, how do you do this? I'm like, it's not that hard. Like, I started doing it because I had the biggest CD collection. Like, that's why I started DJing.
I still have the biggest CD collection. I just can't make terms and let them go.
Yeah. So it's like, that's how I started DJing. Is like, I had the most music. So people are like, oh, you should be a DJ. I'm like, all right, I'm just going to string these things together. Beat matching is not that hard, but there are certain rules like that you kind of follow when you do things. But not everything has to be beat matched. You can make a dramatic pause and then totally flip into something else.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can cut and just do a hard stop. Mm-hmm. But some people don't realize that, you know, you can mark your track so, like, you know that you've got X amount of measures before it kicks into the vocal. Mm-hmm. So you know how long you're mixing over. But it's also, like, how do you read a dance floor? There's certain things. Even if something stupid, like, if you put pink light bulbs over the bar, everybody looks better. Like, everybody looks more flattering in pink lights. Don't give people harsh overhead lights. That's a small, simple little thing. But again, simple thing. When you're starting a night early on, you don't need to blast the music. It does not need to be that hard and loud. Start, you know, at a thing, but start to bring it up slowly, because when you start to bring up the music slowly, people start to talk louder, to talk over the music, and that automatically brings the energy up in a club.
Yeah.
It's that psychology of just, like, mastering the whole thing of just bringing up the music, bringing up the volume.
Same with the podcast.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. Bringing music up, everybody starts talking. The energy goes up.
The energy goes up, exactly. So you do that in a club, and then you bring it up, but never make it so loud that the bar can't make sales. Like, the music should not be so loud that the bar can't make sales. If they can't hear the drink orders, drink orders are getting screwed up because it's too loud, then it's too fucking loud. Like, ultimately, if the bar doesn't make money, you don't make money.
They have to read lips some nights.
Yes. Yeah. I saw somebody climb across a bar to hear somebody's, like, drink order. And I'm like, okay, that's ridiculous. Now that's just dumb. So nobody should make a bartender work harder than they already are. They should not have to straddle the well in order to hear that somebody wants a rum and coke. That's dumb. Right. So, again, it's
I'm in coke and rum and coke.
Exactly.
What?
Right. But it's the thing is, like, you know, if the bar does well, you do well. If the bar makes money, you make money. That is the business side of it. And you can look at a dance floor and I'm going to play all the hot tracks. It's going to be
partnership.
Amazing. It's a partnership. And they've hired you in there. They have not hired you for your ego. They have not hired you to play all your favorite tracks just so all of your friends will come out and, like, hang out.
Right.
If they're hanging out, then they should be buying drinks. Like, it's a business. It's still a business. It's not your basement, you know? So you have to understand that. That's, like, the core thing. When you go to DJ at a club, you can craft the best playlist in the world.
Yeah.
But if people aren't, like, and that's why I don't care if the dance floor clears out. As long as they go to the bar and they start drinking, I'm okay. Like, that's fine. Rotate the dance floor.
And the more they drink, they'll be back to the dance floor.
Yeah. They'll make their way back to the dance floor.
Because they'll dance to anything. Like, Sweet Caroline.
Yeah. Fucking play it. Play it anyways.
But again, it's one of those things. And so there's, like, things that I have learned over time, plus, like, the basic skills, like, you know, how do you count to four? How do you read a wave? Like, it used to be, like, how do you find the groove on the record? Now it's, like, how do you read a waveform when it's going across digitally? You know, what's the best software to use? How should you do this? Ask me the questions. And I've toyed with just doing, like, some small one-off classes like that, and, like, it wouldn't be to make, I'd be like, I don't know, let's donate it to charity, because, like, I'll tell you guys this for free, but if you're willing to pay for it, I'd rather the money go to something important. So that may or may not happen. Again, it's always, I need, like, 18 more hours in a day, if only to sleep.
It's not gonna happen,
but that's the goal. But yeah, no, so it's, you know, it's the power of music, being able to craft that dance floor and being able to move it the way that you want it to move, or just, if it's not moving the way that you want and it's doing its own thing, like, it's an organic thing. It's not you controlling it. It's given back to you. Like, what does it want?
Yeah.
It's a little goldfish. It's a goldfish in a bowl. And you can either feed the goldfish or the goldfish is going to go belly up. So how do you feed the goldfish and keep the goldfish happy? Or, like, one of those freaking Tamagotchis. Like, if we're going to go all 90s.
Sometimes it's hard, but, you know, if you got the music, which you do on a computer.
Yes.
I don't on vinyl. So you get what I got.
Yeah.
It's hard to do sometimes. So
it is. And that's a bigger challenge. Yeah. That's where vinyl DJs really do have to craft their sets, because they have a limited library. Like, they know they're going to play these 15 records,
right,
like, for their set.
I go into, like, Lunchbox and I'll say, don't judge me. I'm buying Taylor Swift, Harry Styles, and Slayer all in the same time. Because I'm also a DJ, and they're like, we don't care.
Yeah. No, honestly.
Are you buying records?
That
yes,
that's all we care.
That's all I care about. Yeah,
it's like
we're not judging you.
Yeah. It's like Amazon. Amazon doesn't know what to offer me anymore. Right. Like I've bought so much random shit for parties and costumes and all sorts of stuff. It's like, so here's, you know, a 6-pack of Coke and a 50-gallon tub of lube and a car battery and maybe an Elmo doll. I don't know what, like, any of these things working for you on their like recommended thing.
Another cool interesting fact about Spider is she's also a big cosplayer.
I am. It's weird. I can't tell if I am or if I was, because the pandemic. No, here's the thing. The pandemic shut down.
You are. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, I'm also big because I'm a giant. But
You dress up and still go to the.
I still play dress up. Yes, I have not stopped playing dress up. But you're I'm right now finding the time to do as much like all the costumes I had planned in 2020 to start working on. Then the pandemic shut everything down. I still have not restarted any of them.
Really?
I still have all the fabric and I bought everything. But I haven't had the mental energy to tackle it, though. Although I started clearing off the craft table. I started doing that last weekend, so I might be close. We'll see.
I was the same way with homebrewing, like gluten-free beer. Mm-hmm. I got every ingredient I need to brew a beer. I just haven't done it yet.
Yeah.
So. But that since COVID, I'm like,
I figured during...
I'm hearing some photo shoots coming up for me.
I was sitting there going, like, during the pandemic, I was just like, I'm going to have all this free time. I'm going to be able to sew all the things and spend all the extra time doing stuff. And instead, I was like, is that my deck? Is that a Mai Tai? I'm just going to sit onto my deck.
That's what everyone did. So Ernest was in a group, Beer With Me or the... The Zoom meetings we would do on Saturday nights.
Yeah. Well, Beer With Me, Charlotte hosted the, actually, it's Beer With Me Network at the time, but we hosted a virtual beer garden.
Yes, that was every Saturday night.
Nice.
Oh, yeah. My God. You just sit down there and get fucking wasted drinking with your friends still. Oh.
Yeah, we ended up having 25 states and like 8 countries were represented.
This was my fear during the pandemic and after the pandemic was that so many people discovered drinking at home because that's all you could do. Because thank God they didn't shut down the ABC stores because we'd all lost our damn minds if that had happened. That was like a mental health thing. We needed that.
I'm pretty sure they said it, alcohol sales went up during. Yeah,
it absolutely did.
Yeah.
And,
oh, hell yeah.
Yeah. And everybody was experimenting at home with different, like, I know my husband and tipsy bartender got like this. Like, although I will say that I love my husband dearly, but every drink is either green drink, blue drink, or red drink. He may call it something else, but the layers never, it's like, what's this? It's an Irish trash can. Green drink. Okay. It's like, what's this? it's a Vulcan's kiss. Purple drink. Got it. Okay. So it's just like, they all looked this, they had different names, they had different ingredients, but because of the, whatever, the blue curacao or the sour mix or whatever, they all ended up having.
He's a cocktail guy.
He will craft beer. Don't get me wrong. He will absolutely craft beer as well.
He likes the dark beers, all right?
He tends to be more of a stouts kind of person, but
I ended up having. Follow him on.
Every season is stout season.
Yeah. Untapped. So.
Untapped, yes. Yeah. If I ever need to know where my husband is, I just go to Untapped. That'll tell me exactly where he is if he's not at home. No, it's funny because he ended up having like one of the most, I called it the most famous hand in on Twitch because he would just constantly hand me drinks all night while it was DJing on Twitch.
Oh, yeah.
But it's what's funny is that everybody got, you know, drank at home. Your drive home, quote unquote, was upstairs or on the couch. So when everybody started to reopen again, I actually think I saw data on this. There actually was an increase in drunk driving accidents because people forgot that their tolerances had changed.
Oh.
And they had... And they had,
that makes sense.
It makes sense, right? Because they were just like, no, I can totally drink 17 beers in an hour. It's totally fine, and I'll get home fine. You're not just going upstairs. You're not just like falling asleep in your clothes. You actually have to drive a very large, very heavy vehicle. So, yeah, it was just... It's just that was my fear, and that's kind of what happened. But then it restabilized, which is good.
Yeah. The virtual beer garden, I kept that open until the last person was like, nope, I'm out.
There were nights I was on it until like 3 o'clock in the morning.
Oh, yeah.
And then
absolutely.
The next morning I'd wake up and like, oh, shit, I drank all that by myself last night? Holy shit.
I thought I was sharing this.
Yeah.
No, it's.
No, but there were nights, because we're all on the camera, there'd just be nights I just My damn camera would go blank. I mean, I was... Oh, well,
we'd have people disappear.
Yeah, I would just vanish. And we're like,
well, their camera's still active.
Yeah.
I'd be passed out, yeah.
Yeah. I'm like, okay, we haven't seen them in 30 minutes. I'm taking them off.
Yeah. No, exactly. But, you know, it's, again, it's that, and that's that weird, that was that visual component of, right. like, the pandemic, where all of a sudden it became this very digitized version in this world where, like, you could do anything from the neck up because nobody could see you from, like,
right.
business meetings to whatever else was going on. And that's where Twitch was interesting, again, connecting with people. But they got to, what was nice is they got to see people. And that, yeah. that to me, what was, like, the first night I did, I actually just streamed straight to Facebook. People seeing each other, quote unquote, like, online and chatting and catching up and just, like, posting pictures of themselves dancing and videos of themselves dancing. Like, that connection is so important, that human connection that we all had shut. We didn't, I think even the most antisocial of us suddenly discovered that they really didn't mind people as much as they right. thought they did. We're still humans. We're still that organism that needs to have some sort of social interaction. Some of us, we all do it in different ways. Some of us are fine just doing it digitally. They don't actually want to see another person. Totally cool with that. Like, you don't want to breathe the same air. That's totally cool. But at the same time, like, some of us just, like, from a DJ perspective, that energy that comes off the dance floor, that feeling that you've done the right thing.
It's a great feeling.
It is a really good feeling. And at the end of the night, when you can say, fuck yeah, that was a great fucking night.
Yeah.
That energy is just, that's amazing. And of course, there are also other nights where I'm like, well, that fucking sucked.
That sucked.
And that's good too, because, I mean, I get very holistic, but it's kind of like you can't see the light unless you have the dark. And vice versa. You have to have both sides of that. You, unless you have that basis for comparison, you don't know. Like, you don't know that this is the greatest album of all time until you hear the really shitty follow-up second album where you're like, nope, that's definitely the best album that band is ever going to put out because everything they've done since is terrible.
So who are some of your favorite industrial acts? And I know there's a lot in that word industrial, because there's a lot of different genres, just like
there is
funk rock and everything else.
We were talking about that earlier. Yeah. So industrial specifically, I mean, there's like, you've got your class. I mean, just like there's classic rock, there's classic industrial.
Yes.
You know, you're going to have like My Life
Ministry,
with the
Thrill, Ministry, Nine Inch Nails,
Nine Inch Nails, My Life with the Thrill Cult, Skinny Puppy. You know, those are like the classics, but there's so many like new bands. Like it for me, it changes almost weekly. Like what I talked to you about earlier today, I would have come in like 2 hours later and been just like, nope, it's all changed.
Yep.
I've heard something new. It's totally like
the same band. Yeah.
Yeah. So it changes a lot, but there's Ultra Sun is great right now. Faderhead is great. And that's just within industrial. And then you get into like EBM, which is industrial body music, which is
that
like,
is Kathy's
EBM
genre
is,
stuff. Yes.
So there's EDM, which is electronic dance music.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
EDM.
Sorry. Yeah.
EBM is very similar, but it's like industrial with a dance beat. Like,
okay.
That's how I would describe it. It tends to be a little bit more pounding. And then you've got industrial bass, which is a new thing, which is just kind of like fucking like hits you right in the crotch, pounding like boom, 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 kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But it's solid. Like, it's still super danceable, but it just is like dirty, grindy kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Industrial metal is still, you know, metal is still.
I love it. That's my favorite. Yeah.
Then you've got like the goth rock side of things. That's still good. Synth pop is all like the Depeche Mode-y, swirly stuff.
Yeah.
And then like just post-punk in general is just, post-punk kind of encompasses a whole bunch of stuff, but you've got like, there's a band called Nightclub, which like, you know, there's certain bands you listen to and you're like, oh, this would cross over. Like, if you hear Nightclub, you'll be like, oh, this could be like, Nine Inch Nails was my gateway drug. Like, was my gateway band to like the dark side. Was Pretty Hate Machine. That was the
Pretty Hate Machine. I'll never forget the first time I heard that album. I was like, who is this?
Yes.
And where can I buy this? Because I need this shit right now.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But it was so different than anything else you heard
it
before.
It was. Yes.
It was very different. But at the same time, it was the first thing that had. There was still other bands doing that stuff. He was just the first one to really get some sort of mainstream attention on stuff.
Right.
And a little bit of the shock value and everything. But then you get into like the whole, like, there's a whole, I want to call it like new wave, because we had that already in the 2000s, but there's this whole new piece of stuff that's drawing a lot from like the very 80s sounds of things and taking them and just modernizing it. So you've got like Actors and Leathers and Nuevo Testamento that actually... Nuevo Testamento sounds a lot like it's got like a little bit of like freestyle going on with it. It's like,
oh,
80s.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's really like you pick it up. Like if you're old, you pick it up in the back of your head and you're like, I know this, like this is familiar, but it's different. It's new. It's
right.
cool. Stabbing Westward, we talked about. Like, they're, like, very, like, managed to have taken, like, what sounded like. They still sound the same, but they sound still current, which is amazing to me. Then there are bands that are taking much more of a punk side to things. And then you just have bands like Garbage just covered Susie and the Banshees.
Yes.
Have you heard that?
No, I haven't heard that.
So
I heard
good.
Florence and the Machine's cover of the Elton John song. What the fuck was that song?
God, oh,
Rocket Man? No. Yeah,
no. It's going to come to us.
Yeah, well.
There have been beverages, adult beverages. So, yeah. But no, that's Susie. Like, it's amazing because Garbage has still been putting out music this whole time. Like, Garbage did not.
Shirley Manson's beautiful. I'm sorry.
And she's great voice, and they've still been touring.
Yeah.
They're still solid. But again, you know, you fall out of the mainstream, and all of a sudden this is, I don't want to say it's going to revive a career because the career doesn't need reviving, but it is going to reintroduce people to going, oh, I thought they were the ones that did that number one crush song or that queer song, and now it's this whole other thing. But covers have been a really good way for people to enter into, like, they hear a cover and they're like, oh, I know this song. Why do I know this song? Oh, holy crap. It's
right.
It's Nirvana, but it's not Nirvana.
I love covers. I'm a sucker for covers.
Oh, yeah. No, I have thousands of covers. Like, covers are my favorite things. And, like, it's one of those things that, it becomes that entry point. Like, I sometimes picture things like one big giant Death Star in the sky, and everything's got a little, like, there's a little door.
Stay on target.
Yeah, stay on target, exactly. There's a little door on each side, and everybody's got their own way into the center. And sometimes you hear it through a cover. Sometimes you just thought you saw interesting artwork on an album.
Right.
Like, I don't know how many bottles of wine I bought because I thought the label was cool. But I'm like, that with
always
bands
gets you, though, doesn't it?
The bands are the same way. You look at a cover and you're like, cool. Or you saw a video, or you saw a t-shirt, or you saw something and you're like, okay, I'm a little bit closer. Or you saw a hot chick and you're like, she's awesome. What's she listening to? You know, whatever your doorway was that got you into, like, a different side or a different musical thing, embrace it, like, find it, and then just expand on it and see what else happens with
it. Death Star of music.
Yes, it's like everything is one big giant googly ball. One giant Death Star.
I love it.
And that's I mean, get in there and enjoy it, but follow it down to the core. I mean, and it doesn't mean that that's where you are forever. Like, you'll find there will be other bands. There will be other music.
I love finding new music. Well, it's funny because, you know, I don't think you use Spotify, but Spotify does, like, a weekly new music thing for you.
Yes, they do. Mm-hmm.
Every week. And it's funny because there's times I
get release radar.
Yes. And I know that too. But no, there's actually two of them. There's a new, it'll try and find new music for you. 90% of the time I've heard all those songs before. Mm-hmm. I'm like, oh, I know all these. But every once in a while,
there's that one. And you're
one,
like,
I'm like, ooh, who's this? That's how I got hooked on Three Teeth.
Three Teeth.
Mm-hmm. It played that Time's Up song.
Yes.
And I was like, whoa, who's this? And then I dug deeper, and I found the cover of Pumped Up Kicks.
Yeah.
And I was like, all right, now these guys are awesome. Yeah.
Yeah, and there's a Aesthetic Perfection is a fairly big name within our scene for a band. And he's curated a list called This Is Industrial Pop, and he has a playlist on Spotify.
Oh, I'll have to find that, yeah.
Yeah, it's actually really interesting because he's very big on the pop structure of a song, because pop songs have a certain structure. Like, there's a bridge, there's an opening, there's a closing. It's not just like random noises, not like Newbouton, which is like 7.5 minutes of me banging on a can. It's actually like got song structure and everything else around it.
Well, we've been conditioned to know as music.
Yeah, exactly. But it's just, you know, for quote unquote bands that are not mainstream to adopt that structure and make songs that are good, but you would never listen to them because they're not, you know, Taylor Swift. You know, so you may miss them, but he's curated a fantastic list of songs that are, I don't want to say like, but they're bridge songs. They're songs that can introduce you to a whole new world. So it's called This Is Industrial Pop on Spotify. There's some great stuff on there. But Halsey's last album, produced by Trent Reznor.
Really?
Yes. Demi Lovato's new album. Fuck. I will tell you right now, there's some shit on there that is absolutely like, I wouldn't call it necessarily goth, but it's definitely emo.
No shit.
Yeah, no, her. It came up recommended to me, and I was just like, all right, we'll give it a shot. We'll see. I'm open-minded. And I was like, okay, girl's working through some shit, and that's cool.
I thought she was going through some issues. We went to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, I think, in October, and the whole top floor was all Nine Inch Nails stuff.
Was it really?
I was like, wow, this is cool. They had the outfit he wore, I think, at Lollapalooza when he got all the...
Not everything?
Yes.
They People had that hold on to the weirdest shit.
Yeah.
Yeah. And but I was at Cold Waves in Chicago, and it was my first time going to a festival that I wasn't involved with, which was amazing. Like, I could come and go when I left. Yeah, I'd never gone to, like, a music festival before.
That.
It was just, like, it was just so nice to be just there for the music and not have to watch a watch. Like, I had to be somewhere else. But it was, like, 3 days of music, but I got to see some... I saw Revolting Cox, you know? I saw...
Well, didn't Al play some last night?
Al was... I mean, Mystery played last night, yeah. So, Al was there.
I'm sorry. Last time I saw them was at Al up in Asheville. He played Revolting Cox songs.
Oh, yeah. No, he didn't play...
He played 10,000 homo DJ songs. Yeah. He played, like, everything he's ever done.
No, he only played... he only did one cover, and it was a Fad Gadget song of all things.
Oh, really?
Yeah, which
wow,
I thought
okay,
was...
okay,
yeah,
right.
It was a weird... I was like, okay, there's a reach. But, no, it was just... And Revco is now calling themselves Revolting Corpse because they swear this is their last tour, and everything is kind of fading out. But, I mean, again, it was seeing those legends, like seeing Nitzareb and seeing... seeing Nitzareb and seeing like Front 242 and all these amazing names. But also there was this one amazing moment. We were at the Riviera in Chicago for the last night, and Front 242 was the headliner because they got their biggest start in Chicago.
Yeah.
So huge room, loudest show I have ever been at. Like water was vibrating on the bar.
Oh shit.
Yeah. I had to go to the back of the Riviera because I'm like, okay, like I've been doing this for a long time and I still have good
chest. Yeah.
I still have good hearing. I'd love to keep it that way.
Well, so
it was still back to the back and it was still totally fine. But there were some younger bands that were playing. One of them was Light Asylum. Had never seen Light Asylum perform before. Had really not any idea what to expect. Shannon is an African-American woman that just owned that stage just with a backing track. And she was half 90s club kid, half Earth Mother Goddess, half like just involved with the whole thing. And I could see like Nitzareb and Front 242 off stage watching her. And then later she was up in like the balcony seats watching her, like the people that influenced her. And they were filming and watching, like filming. It was just this moment of like
that's
beautiful,
phenomenal.
Like circle, like the circle of life kind of thing, where it was just like, this is what it should be. It should be like people seeing what's coming, people looking back, but embracing it all together.
Yes.
And it was just, it was one of those nights where it's just like, it's like seeing legends there, but also seeing like future legends and seeing people that are going to be these huge new influences. Bands that I had never heard of, never seen live before, seeing them live, just going, wow. Like
I've gotten hooked on so many bands by going early and seeing the opening act.
Yeah, don't ignore the opening act. No, like I know sometimes timing's tough, you're getting off work or whatever, mm-hmm. but like take that time. Like, you know, your makeup looks fine. Your hair is fine.
Yeah.
You know, you don't have to wear your good bra. You can wear your regular bra.
Most places are dark.
I go through
dingy.
All those things when I'm...
Don't you when you get dressed? Yeah. You look like you take extra time. But no, that's the thing is like, you should absolutely go and because you don't know if those bands are going to be great. They could be terrible. But I saw a show at the Milestone that I was a group that I mean, whole mix of bands. There was like it started with a sort of a rap thing going on. Then it went to a synth pop thing. Then went to like, I mean, it was just a varied, and I wouldn't have seen Be Villainous just because they were on the bill, but then walked in. I'm just like, okay, this guy is amazing. And he's throwing off rhymes like freaking I don't know what, and I'm here for it. Like, yes, please. Just sat there and watched. He was amazing. There was a guy that came through with Danny Blue a few months back, maybe 6-8 months ago, and he was doing, he's an industrial, but more like dancey EDM type stuff, and he just started throwing down, and I just, one guy on stage, and I was just like, 6 months, this guy is going to be something. And sure enough, one of his tracks got played what's the big Florida Winter Music Conference, WMC or Ultra Music Fest.
Okay,
one of those big ones. Somebody was throwing down one of his tracks down there.
Oh, shit.
Yeah. And
that's
that
awesome.
Was, yeah, that's amazing.
I've seen him before. Yeah,
yeah, exactly. And he was blown away by it. But I was just like, dude, as soon as I saw him play, I'm like, this guy, this is all original shit. And he's nailing it. And I'm like, this is exciting to be able to see that with like 10 other people. And you're looking around going, are you seeing this? Do you see what we're seeing? This is a moment. Look for those moments. And also it's encouraging, man. Like don't like an opening band always has to, like they have to bite the bullet. Like they always have to come in. It's like, sun's still up. Nobody has their makeup on.
Right.
I'm just going to play to whoever's here.
If see, I, If I like them, I'll always go and try and like buy some.
Yeah, buy some merch or merch, buy something. Because
it helps them get to the next venue, man.
It does. It absolutely
does. They're on the road, and they're broke, so.
Yeah, I own more black T-shirts than I know what I'm going to do with. Like, I made a promise to myself after the pandemic.
My whole closet's full of black
T-shirts. Yeah. But I made a promise after the pandemic. So let's buy the ticket, see the band, get the merch. That was because there were so many bands I missed because they said, I'll see them the next time around. And then, you know, you lose your Bowies. You lose your Princes. You know, and now, like, we have
you
a lot of...
You lose your Joe Strummers.
Yeah. And now you've got a whole bunch of bands on tour right now that are... They're saying, like Skinny Puppy said, it was the last tour ever.
Yeah.
They're bands that know that, you know, they would like to stop doing this. Mm-hmm. And I appreciate that because it's
40
exhausting.
40 years of Skinny Puppy.
Yeah.
40 fucking years.
It's exhausting.
Yeah.
You know, we still love it, but they're probably tired of playing the same fucking songs all the time. Bless their hearts. Yeah. But again, you know, Ogre and all those guys, I mean, they're going out the way that they want to go out. So... Take the time, go see the bands, support the music, because without those bands and the music, you don't have, like, we don't have the club stuff.
Right.
You know? And they may be back.
Yeah.
Because, you know, a lot of the groups that we listened to in the 80s and went and seen, you know, they disappeared for a decade or even longer, and now they're back.
No, exactly. Stabbing Westward. I don't think anybody had thought about them since the 90s.
No.
You know, what do I have to do? And then now this new album, and now they're remixing. I mean, I think they were still doing some remixes on the side. But it's just absolutely blown up.
Yeah.
And to be honest, like, if you had told me in the 80s that Trent Reznor was going to win a fucking Academy Award, you know, seriously. I would have been like.
He's a fucking genius, though. He is.
Yeah, he is. But at the same time. It was
musical genius.
If you told me that after listening to Head Like a Hole, I would have been like, nah,
no way.
You're an idiot. You're dumb.
That
but
was
no,
it's one of the greatest shows I ever saw was him.
Oh,
with,
greatest lighting.
Perfect Circle, yes.
Of any show I've ever been to.
You know what? Lighting has come so... I have this conversation a lot. Lighting has come so far. And last night's show, there was...
Absolutely.
If you have the right lighting person, like, I get excited. And I can... Oh, look, I made a strobe. You know, I get excited from a DJ perspective. Because I'm not... I appreciate lighting, but I don't have the skills to do it. I just let things run. But there's so many, like, you see some... I mean, EDM has done a lot for that. Like, they have these huge... Like, you can't even see the DJ. There are these huge, just massive shows. But if you can time, like, the lighting on something, if you can time, like, when it goes dark, when it goes light, it's the same thing with music. You bring it down, you bring it up. You do the same thing with the lights. But Gary Newman, Lost in Shadows, just sort of backlit a little bit in the background, total entrance. Like, it just is absolutely, like, some things. There's a band called Alice, A-L number one, C-E. They'll actually be up in Winston-Salem on Wednesday. They came through Charlotte last year. One of the best lighting shows I've ever seen. The Milestone has never looked better.
They have upped their game a lot with the lighting. Yes.
Yeah, no, but Al's brought their own lighting in. And when I saw the footage afterwards, I was kind of like, what is this place that I was in that did not look like this? I was like, this is all fancified and shit. It was, they when you've got somebody that's programmed the music and the lights to work well together, it's amazing.
It's a show.
It's a show.
It's a great show.
But that's, again, it's that whole full emotional, visceral, like, full on. Yeah. It's you have to hit all the senses.
Yeah.
And, you know, embrace it all. So, yeah.
So I think we're going to wrap this up soon. Do you have anything you want to plug? Any
what do I want to plug?
DJ gigs soon?
Yeah, actually, well, I'll be in Augusta this coming Saturday at the Black Cat for Atmosphere. And then here in Charlotte on May 20th, we have Goth Prom for Digital Noir.
I saw that, yeah.
I know, we're getting all fancy. Last year, we actually sold out the Milestone.
Really?
I know, there was a 45-minute wait to get in.
No shit.
For the Milestone, I know.
Wow.
And people are all purdy and stuff. And so I'm bringing back the same DJ I had, DJ 20th Century Boy out of Raleigh. He's going to come down. He does all vinyl, so he's...
Oh, okay,
he's,
cool.
And he's,
yeah,
again, super nice person. He'll be down, so we're doing that. And then after that, it's kind of just sort of coasting. I'm at the Milestone every other month. I pick up other stuff as it comes up.
Cool.
Twitch whenever I can. But honestly, just support everything in Charlotte. Like, we've got Digital Noir. It goes on monthly. I'm just alternating with DJ Price because we both realized we have lives. And it's exhausting after a while to do it. Like, yeah. I'm like, I look back when I used to do the Breakfast Club. I'm like, the fuck did I do this every week? How did I do this every Thursday? Like,
I love that venue, though. Man,
was
that was a great
so
place.
So great. So actually, I ran into Stefan and Jarrett last night at the show, the bartenders, the old bartenders. And we're actually like, we need to do a Breakfast Club Thursday night reunion.
Yeah.
We're talking about it. So keep your ears peeled for that. That may actually happen.
Hell yeah.
We were drunk enough to actually make this happen. So last night, we actually, those conversations were, we weren't so drunk we were going to forget, but drunk enough in the morning, I was like, oh, fuck yeah. We talked about that. That sounds awesome.
Yes.
But I was actually, joke again, you chat with people, it's just like, you know, kids today, they don't understand like where you had to like roll into the, you know, to work the next morning with the hand stamp still on your hand.
I've done that before. A little, like, oh shit.
Yeah. A little glitter still on your face or whatever. Now they work from home. They can just go to work in their pajamas. Doesn't matter if they showered or not. We'd be rolling in going, yeah, it's just eyeliner. It's cool, man.
Yeah.
It's fine. Yeah, it's a different environment, but like we do again, digital noir at the Milestone, every month. It's one of the few DJ nights that they do, but it's a fucking pleasure to play there. It's a fucking privilege because that place is historic and it is
absolutely.
And Buck and the crew there are just
one
amazing.
Of the oldest punk rock clubs on the East Coast. Now,
it is
so,
actually. It's over, that building is over 100 years old now.
Wow. It is the oldest.
It is the oldest because and CBGB's is closed now. So it is the oldest, longest running club in the world. The Go-Go's play late there.
Black Flag, Green Day,
Nirvana played there. Yeah. REM slept on the floor because they couldn't afford a hotel room. Kesha was there and bought everybody shots.
No shit.
Yeah, Kesha's been there and bought everybody shots one night. So
that was fun.
Who's Kesha?
But again, just one of those. I mean, it's an honor to play on that stage, and it's history. You don't want to see it in broad daylight, but it's history. It's held together with stickers, sweat, and broken drumsticks. But it is history. But
those places look much different when the lights are on.
They do, but it's, again, you see that history. Like that Bad Brains tag up on the corner, that is actually
Bad
Brains.
It's been there
forever, but it's Bad Brains. Like, it's not, somebody just didn't write that. They actually wrote that.
Yes.
And then you've got here at Tommy's Pub, you've got Reflections here once a month, and that's DJ Velveteen, and she brings in some guests periodically.
Yeah.
And then over at Crown Station, you've got DJ Christian and DJ Kraftwerk, and they do sort of an 80s, 90s night over there.
I have yet to be the Crown Station, so.
Crown Station's actually a neat little venue. It's a good, I mean, the fact that you can get coffee and booze is kind of a nice in this town. Yeah.
I'm pretty sure you can get that here at Tommy's, too, though.
Yeah, but sometimes you got to find the
but
coffee.
But it's fucking Folgers.
Yeah, and you've got to, they get a little bit craftier there. Yeah. And then there's also, there are a couple of other, Tip Top has a night every once, I think it's monthly there, and the name escapes me, but that's more of an experimental industrial night. And then Snug Harbor's been bringing in bands on a fairly regular basis once a month as part of their Dark Matter series.
Okay.
And they've been doing a great job, like good bands, like coming up next Saturday, Corinne is playing, and they are a post-punk with a kind of an 80s vibe sound, but they played Charlotte last year and one of the best shows I saw last year. So I'm really looking forward to seeing them on
a
Saturday
night. Next Saturday night?
Next Saturday, the 14th.
All right.
Whatever the Saturday is before Mother's Day. But they actually, on their new album, they actually released a song called Mount Airy. So there's a little North Carolina kind of thing there for you.
I think it's the 13th.
Is that the 13th?
I think the 14th is actually Mother's Day.
It's Mother's Day. So it's the third. It's the Saturday before. So. But then you've got just bands. Everybody reaches for their phones. If you can't see this, everybody's reaching their phones to double check the dates. Calendars.
Yes, calendars.
Calendars.
Because now it's funny. I'm getting that age where I got to put shit in here.
No. Trust me.
Yes, 13th.
13th. And then you've got, there's a ton of burlesque in this town as well that does.
Ooh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, no, we've got, we've got
that piqued your interest.
Yeah, it did.
We've got the Flamingo Review. They do shows quarterly at, I believe it's quarterly over at the Visualite. You've got Stardust Burlesque. They do stuff over at Stroke Putt Putt. You've got Tool Chest Productions. They do stuff periodically. I think they actually might be at, they've been at Tommy's before. I don't know if they're coming back to Tommy's, but they're actually, the Flamingo Review actually did a Nine Inch Nails tribute show for New Year's Eve.
The
Milestone, which was amazing. I was like, you know what? I love Nine Inch Nails. I don't know if you can do an entire night of burlesque to Nine Inch Nails. Fuck yeah, you can.
You can.
Yeah, you can. It was amazing.
I can see that.
Yeah, I was like, I thought I was going to get tired of it. But in the end, I was just like, no, this is awesome. and plus, you know, everybody's like the Fillmore, you know, granted it's a mainstream venue and it's going to be what you expect from a mainstream venue, but we did have Ministry and Paul, Gary Newman and Frontline Assembly there last night.
Yes.
And I'm sure they'll be had Skinny Puppy a couple of weeks ago.
Oh yeah.
So, you know, there are bands touring. It's just, sometimes you have to look and find. So like, don't be afraid to ask. Here in Charlotte, if you go on Facebook and you go to the Charlotte Dark Scene page, we try to book anything or make note of anything that's within driving distance is kind of a rule. So like anything in Charlotte, but also like, is it up in Wilmington? Is it up in, you know, in Asheville? Is it up in Raleigh? Is it down in Atlanta? Would somebody drive 3 or 4 hours to get to a big show? Yeah, then we try to like make sure people know about it because we want, you know, to encourage that travel and just to encourage the scene in general. And if you're booking through Charlotte, you know, you can contact us through there and we can connect you with the people in Charlotte that are actually, you know, here's who you talk to at the Milestone. Here's who you talk to at, you know, Skylark. Here's who you talk to here at Tommy's. So we try to be like a conduit for stuff. If you are in Charlotte, the 20th is Goth Prom. The 21st, that Sunday, is Goth Picnic. We're having the World Goth Day Picnic. World Goth Day is actually the 22nd. It's an actual holiday.
Okay.
World Goth Day is May 22nd. The 21st is Sunday. We started doing the picnic before the pandemic. Then pandemic, everything shut down. So now we do the Goth. We're bringing it back for the first time since the pandemic. And it's just a very, we're going to be doing it at the Marion Deal Center. Bring a dish. Bring some ice. Doesn't matter. It's just a very casual, it's a picnic. Just a casual, like that you can bring like the kids, you know, and just get to know people in the scene without feeling like it's too pretentious because it's dark and they look spooky and they're wearing a lot of eyeliner and I can't talk to them.
Some of the nicest people that you'll ever meet, though. So yeah,
absolutely. And people always come to me and say that, like, I'm like, you just, you're a DJ. I can't talk to you. I'm like, no, come talk to me. I'm a giant goofball. Like, I'm, not, I'm a giant goober. I will always talk to anybody who wants to talk. So, but Goth Picnic is coming up on the... I love this track. This is Ultra Sun.
I like it.
Yeah, I do too.
Well, I think that's it for the week. Ernest, you got anything?
You've just let me babble. Thank you.
No, everything I've had is in the past, and can't think of anything that's coming up. So
I have no shows coming up and nothing. I did go to, I did participate in Record Store Day. I only bought one fucking record, though. Death. Greatest hits, which they never had any greatest hits, so I don't know why it was called that, but I still bought it. Anyways, that's it for this week. Thank you, DJ Spider, for coming
on
the show.
Thank you guys for having me. You
Thank you, Tommy's, for letting us come in.
Hey, Tommy's.
Adios.
Smoochies.
A huge shout out to our gracious host, Tommy's Pub. Located at 3124 East Wade Drive, Tommy's Pub is a small neighborhood bar that's big on music and community. Go to Tommy's Pub's Facebook page where they regularly provide updates about upcoming events to include weekly open mic night, karaoke, and live music from some of the best up-and-coming bands in the Queen City. Thank you, Tommy's Pub, for hosting M-Vibes Podcast.
We have a lot of interesting episodes coming up about music's most interesting topics, but we want to hear from you and what episodes you'd like to hear. If you have an idea for anything we should talk about, email us at mbiaspodcast@gmail.com. This episode was produced by BWM Productions. If you like our podcast, please help us by rating and reviewing us on your favorite listening platform. And follow us on Instagram and Facebook at mbiaspodcast. Come on and join in the conversation.